So, in terms of, you said that in 10 minutes after death, you can revive a person medically. How will you claim it in your work?
See, it can be revived. Perhaps it can be revived by 5 minutes, 8, 10 minutes, I don't know.
5 to 10 minutes.
That's not.
And if the temperature is low, even after hours.
That's right. What I'm telling you.
Hello.
When, suppose, could that mean that when he dies once again, I can do it once again?
Yes.
I can do it once again. In other words, can he keep him permanently like that? I can't.
If a person is having cardiac arrest, his heart has stopped.
Yeah.
His Vyan Vayu and Saman Vayu has stopped. His Pran Vayu is still there. Yeah. His brain is still alive. In that situation, if you resuscitate, if he is revived, if he is revived, he revives. If he has cardiac arrest again, you can revive him again.
Okay.
Till the Udan Vayu leaves the body, as per Ayurveda.
Ah.
As per Ayurveda. Because in Ayurvedic language, they say is that if your heart has stopped, the Prana Vayu is still in your body, the Udan Vayu is still in your body. And because that consciousness is in your body, if you revive the heart, you can revive the person.
See, this last phrase is a little clarity is necessary. See, consciousness is always there. That's not the question. Consciousness is everywhere. But here, you define it as jiva. That is with these vrittis. Okay. Udan Vayu, if still it has not left, it could be revived. There's no doubt about that. And I can tell something more. If by some yogic practices, it can also be revived even little later. Okay. But there are exceptional things which won't come under a sort of a medical system. That argument itself is, it becomes irrelevant. Okay. But as long as Udan Vayu does not leave the body, certainly it can be manipulated. It is not indefinitely. There is an end of karma. After karma is over, it can never be resuscitated. Therefore, it could be possible, but it will have only limitedness. I don't know, if his karma were like that, he could be alive for one more year, maybe, or 6 months, 2 months, or whatever. But sometime it has to come to an end. And it's the Udana which takes the jiva to other places. Other lokas.
Okay. Now, the second thing is then when we read Katha Upanishad, and there's a description of Nachiketa sacrifice and Nachiketa fire. What is that?
Nachiketa?
Fire. The fire.
Oh.
The sacrifice.
What nothing does it to do with
it. Nothing to do with
it. Nothing with this. It's entirely different. There are three varas. It is the middle one.
Yes.
It has no connection with this at all. It has no connection whatsoever with the process of life and death.
There's no absolutely...
Absolutely no connection.
That's
some yajna.
That is some yajna.
That's
not
anything else. Not related.
Now, it is also, when we talk about cellular death, we talk about that the liver cell dies within 6 weeks, the skin cell dies within 4 weeks, the stomach cell dies within 5 weeks, we have the skeletal cell dies within 12 weeks, and then we have the whole brain dying within 1 year. That means the whole human body, every cell in my body, the maximum life is 2 years. That means after every 2 years, my complete cells have changed. So today, if I have a cancer, and my liver is producing cancer cells, and when I know the new liver cell will come back after 6 weeks, that means the life of my cancer can be 6 weeks if I do something and my new liver cells are not cancerous cells. Is it possible?
See.
If yes, how do we incorporate in our practice?
See.
How do we add on to our allopathic practice?
See, for instance, I mean, it's a joke. Somebody said, I'm having this knife. Ooh, since 4 generations. And after some time, he was wondering, and told, only a few years ago, the handle had gone and I replaced it. and my father replaced the blade. Okay. That's why the handle is replaced by one and the knife is replaced by another, but the knife continues as a whole. Okay. Like this, oh, when all the cells die together,
they cannot.
They cannot.
One by
it
one.
It is just as simple as this. You take any machine, something goes, you replace it. Something goes, you replace it. Something goes, you replace it.
Absolutely.
And finally, when the engine itself dies, you can't do anything.
Absolutely.
I like that.
So what I'm trying to say, how to incorporate Vedic practice, Vedic knowledge into my clinical practice so that I convert hell into heaven in the same word.
Oh,
the same
see, if you insist on an answer for heaven and hell, I will have to tell something different.
Okay.
See, heaven and hell are there.
Absolutely.
It is not only here. So if I suffer here, it is hell. If I am happy here, it is heaven. It is not like that. It is there, there. And this person who carries Vakgurti, Manovurti, Pranavurti, a part of the karma could involve such a papa and punya for which he has to go to heaven and hell and heaven. Okay. There, he gets what is known as an Atibahika Sharira. He gets another body, which is unlike this. Okay. And there he suffers. I mean, somewhat similar to the body in the dream. Something similar to. Okay. Then he suffers that. He comes back. Okay. Now, the evidence for this, the pramana for this is only the Shastra. But nevertheless, you can convince yourself by an argument like this. When does one go to heaven and hell? After totally disconnecting from this body. Okay. Now you know, when one disconnects from the body, he goes from the wakeful state to the dream state. Now in dream state, his experiences are funny, extremely different. Okay. Therefore, when you leave the connection with the body, if you can have funny experiences in dream, jolly well, after death it could also be there. Therefore, it's a plausibility argument. Okay. Therefore, sir, heaven and earth cannot be ruled out. Definitely they are there. But his suffering here itself is only the papa and punya that can be suffered here. Heaven and hell, the papa is more severe. The punya is also more severe. It can't be suffered here. You will have to go there.
So
that's your.
Even if I believe that hell and heaven exist.
Yeah.
Suppose I am 53 today. Suppose I am going to live till 73.
Yeah.
Why should I be bothered about hell and heaven, which I am going to get at the age of 73? Let me first get concerned about hell and heaven, at least for the next 23 years, that in this, if I start doing positive karmas today, and if I am going to improve my next 23 years, automatically, I will neutralize my pap enough not to enter into the hell.
You are perfectly correct.
So if that's so, what is my lifestyle as a doctor, which should I incorporate in my patients? What are the Vedic prescriptions I start giving to my patients? I'm talking about when I give, I write down aspirin, I write down amlodipine, I write a few drugs. What are other Vedic prescriptions I should start adding to my patients so that they start neutralizing their bad karmas from today?
Thanks.
See, very difficult to say sach bolo. When I say sach bolo, gussa mat karo, the patient says, Doctor, sir, gussa nahi karo, mujhe bhi pata hai. Tell me what to do. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Can I convert spirituality into a medical prescription?
Very good. In fact, this is an excellent question. There will be a too huge list of
sure,
but I will take one example. I seize this as an opportunity to place it before you. In fact, I'm thankful to you for asking this question. I will take one example. The example is the following. The periods in the case of women, monthly periods. A lot of literature is there, of which I am finding that even working doctors are ignorant. Actual working doctors. There is a lot of literature with the research groups. For instance, in America, they have seen that a person in periods, if she comes into contact with another woman whose period is not that, by contact she also becomes. There is sort of a contagion there. Next, for instance, in a German company, they were making computer chips. What they saw is the computer chips, because it's a delicate work, only women were deputed to do this. Now they noticed about, I think about 40 years ago, that the chips are getting burnt at a certain time. Therefore, they studied the periodicity and they thought it must be linked with this. Okay. Then they concluded, during that time, when they are manufacturing computer chips, they are getting burnt. Okay. Now this is a well-known information. In here, in our country, in Israel and other places, what they are solving the problem the following way. They want to prepare chips. Therefore, women have to do, because it is a delicate work. They say, chips have to be prepared. Who will come for testing? They will say. And some women will say, we can't come. They know, because we can't come. Oh, okay. All right, you can come later. They'll say. Whereas, in the West, what they have done is, they have given grounded chairs. You go on doing it. It doesn't matter. Okay. And they have come out with tablets to prevent this periodicity. Okay. And they also give slogans like free and all these things. Okay. Now, in American Army, what has happened is, the army generals have written, women all are equal. Okay. Therefore, they were appointed even in the army. And the army generals wrote after a few years, see, it is impossible to take work from them. The whole battalion sits. And we can't take any work from them. Therefore, appoint them anywhere else, not in the army. But they have cared two hoots for this. They are continuing to do this. Okay. Whereas in Japan, I am told, they are sanctioning leave. Okay. I want to know, one who is interested in the health of the woman, what he will do, they do in Japan. One who is interested in income, they will do what they are doing in US and the West. For instance, during the periods, women are not expected to bathe according to Shastra. Okay. Now, Shastra itself tells, it's a very big description and I don't want to enter into it. Okay. It terms firmly that you cannot take bath at the time, should not. And when you sleep, there should be contact with the earth. Specifically, it is told in the Shastra. Shastra says, you cannot sit on, wooden chairs, wooden cots. Okay? You should be grounded at that time. Okay. Then, what is happening? When they start bathing, it is simply common sense, just plain common sense. Suppose fluids are going out. Even take, for instance, urination. Suppose you put water on the body, it stops. It's common sense. Therefore, here in society, they say you have to take 3 baths every day. And if they say you should not take baths during these 3 days, do you mean to say they're unclean? Should there not be a valid reason? And this being practiced since immemorial past? And now what has happened? I think it is endosterosis or something like that, you say? Nowadays? As some doctor told, it is chocolate disease. Now what is happening? This is going back. All the fluids are going back. And going back, they collect. And they're putting pressure on the inside organs. There is gradual deterioration. What is the result? The result is money. I am putting it plainly. Therefore, it does not at all mean that all the research work is known. They know it, but they don't want to tell it. This is hypocrisy and it is criminal. In fact, I know cases where women came with some skin diseases and the doctor told, are you taking bath? No. I'm taking. Please don't take bath. For 6 months, you see. For 6 months, she stopped and the skin was improved. This is experience. Therefore, here, because somebody says they are high or free and all that, and our people are also following, it is ruining. This disease, chocolate disease, was an exclusive thing for the West. Now it has started only since during 10 years because of your funny concept of cleanliness. Who is responsible for this? I appeal to all of you. You are doctors. You are yourself women. Take care of this. This society, I don't want to allow it to be ruined. At the top of my voice, I will shout. It's impossible. This is disallowed. This criminality should not work. This is one of the rules. It's only a small example that I am giving. Now you say everything, women's freedom, women's freedom, women's freedom. And if the woman is employed, if she is taken out of the house, it will help business. She wants a grinder, she wants this mixing machine, she wants the washing machine, this, that, so on and so forth. Then she wants a crutch. And the baby, children get spoiled, they go to take drugs and this, and that will also be there. And her own health is spoiled, then they will get money. In every way to extract money, these slogans are held. These slogans are meant for extracting money. Nothing else.
So let me change to another thing. When we talk about, in medical science, we talk about past life regression. There are psychiatrists who take you to your past lives, and they try to and which is something which is scientifically possible and yet impossible. So what are your concepts about that in your during life you can see your past?
Actually, this is not impossible, but actual cases that are taking place, I have got doubts about their validity. But I don't say it is impossible. But it could be possible only as special achievements of yoga. But doing some sort of mesmerism and all that, I don't think it's
possible. So in a complete
state of... But theoretically, it is not impossible.
If you are in a complete state of sympathetic to parasympathetic mode medically, and if you are in a pure state of parasympathetic mode, in that situation, it is possible for you to relax enough to be able to be in touch with your consciousness, in touch with your God, and see the past life. But for that, what Guruji says is, you have to become like a Maharishi to acquire those qualities, to acquire that software, then only you can do. An ordinary doctor may not be able to do. An ordinary doctor may not be able to do as far as this is concerned. In mythology, they say that the first 6 months of child, first 6 months of birth, it is possible for the child is pure, he is pure consciousness, and terminally at the time of death, you are pure consciousness. At the time of death, that's the reason they say, Marta wo aadmi jhoot nahi bolta. The person never lies at the time of death.
Very good.
So is it possible that at the time of death, to make a person realize about his mistakes and repent and try to remove some of it? Therefore, they say, in Bhagavad Gita, they say that the best time to die is whatever you think the whole life, you think at the time of death. Whatever you are thinking at the time of death, that will be your rebirth. Therefore, at the time of death, what do I do as a doctor to change the psyche of a dying person? That means, how do I help a dying person to change his vikriti so that at least some of the karmas he can utilize?
You have once again raised a very interesting question. Those who are familiar with the works of Piaget, child psychology. You will know it from It agrees terribly with, very well with this. Let me be brief, very brief, because it's a very complicated question. Everybody very spontaneously has the feeling, looking at the body, I am this. I am man, woman, etc. That is, everyone identifies with the body, naturally. But in the case of babies, almost up to 3, 4, 5 years, there will be no identification with the body. That is the reason why they look so pure and so charming. If they are simply healthy, it is sufficient. Anybody would like a child. Because they have no identity with it. They don't identify themselves with the body. Okay. Therefore, at that time, it doesn't mean that they are able to remember something like that. Because some people have made some efforts and this has led to a lot of confusion. Suppose he makes some statement. This has happened in NIMHANS. Some people wanted to do this. Some ideas triggered and the child says some funny statement it makes. Then they go on insisting. Then what happens is that develops it as a habit. They go on saying, oh, then I did. Something like that. Nobody can prove that. Therefore, all those researchers for which they spent quite a lot of money have just gone a waste. Okay. Whereas, at the moment of death, if you want to keep the man pure, I will give an example. I think it may be appropriate. There was an young boy. Gradually came to know that his father is a very wicked fellow. He came beyond description. He had told it. I kept quiet. Sometime later, I asked him, every day are you in the habit of doing namaskar to your mother and father? I asked. Sir, to my father? Why not? Of course, he was taking me seriously. He had some value. So next day, he started doing namaskar to mother and father. The father on the first day shouted back. Okay, he used all sorts of vulgar words. Get lost. He persisted, did the second day. Did I not tell you not to do namaskar to me? The third day he did. Really, don't do, he said. Okay. Fourth day, fifth day. What happened? He's coming down. And after a very short time, his end came. Then he called all the children. I am a sinner. Throughout life I have sinned. And I have got children who are so glorious. I don't know how it has happened. All of you please forgive me. He said. Now what is this? Shastra teaches us. What does it teach? Irrespective of how your father and mother is, it is your responsibility to do namaskar and be obedient to them. Now what happens? This in turn changed the man. At the moment of death, he was purer. There was less sin in him because he's repenting. Therefore, the whole conduct of the whole family should be in this way. So they give rules like this. Right? How you should behave in daily life with regard to father, with regard to mother, with regard to children. For instance, with regard to children, Shastra says very clearly, if you want to praise your teacher, you can praise. If he is a real teacher, he won't believe it. Okay, he is telling something, he will say. And if you want to praise your relative, don't praise him directly. Praise him before somebody else. And if you want to praise your servants, after service is over, you praise them. Fourthly, never praise your children. This is the law, according to Shastra. Now, there, what is the system? Oh, wow, keep it up. Ah, remarkable. Oh, you have done excellent. You're super. These sorts of comments are made. And every child is becoming hopeless. The level is going down. Children should not be praised. They should be loved. In fact, you will be creating unnecessary awareness of their own body and all that. It will develop ego without talent. Therefore, these are some of the things. As you asked, no? Specific rules of life. Specific rules of life, if we start living according to the Shastra, the whole family will be like Nandanavana. There's no doubt about that. But if you go on imitating, somebody is there, somebody, they are actually ruining. They are gone. In fact, I think it may be almost a decade or two decades more, they won't be US. This is the actual affair, state of affairs now. What is the meaning in copying them?
So if somebody is dying, and I know that he is going to die, I want to ease death for him. I'm not talking about mercy killing. And he is in torture. What should be a dying atmosphere?
Actually,
should it be full of Gayatri Mantra? Should it be lighted, yajna, light, candle?
No.
What should be the atmosphere at home or in ICU? Yes. Should I shift him to home? People ask me that my father is dying. Should I shift him at home or should I let him die in the hospital? In the hospital, they say, should I let him die in the ventilator on an ICU or should I shift him in the room? These are the questions asked to us every day. That how will you help easing out my father's death in terms of karmic bondage?
Dr. Ji, you have asked a very, very good question, very interesting question. But I don't know how you like the answer.
But that's what we face every day.
The answer is, when you are almost sure, you simply send him home. This has got its disadvantages, but it is good for him. Because, see, there will be people all friendly, and they may tell some shloka, this, that, so on and so forth. So it will be a more peaceful affair. Sometimes we see these people are kept in ICU for 6 months, 1 year. Kailashasram Mathadishwar, he was kept for nearly 2 years. What is fun in that? There's no meaning in that. Therefore, what generally in traditional family, what happens is, the moment they have started going, everybody knows, then they will start singing Lalita Sahasrama, Vishnu Sahasrama, all these things. So, there will be sort of a festive atmosphere. All of them will be singing. Of course, some people will be crying. So, this is sort of atmosphere that is maintained. That atmosphere you can't give in an ICU. A peaceful death is possible only amidst his own people.
Okay. There is a description in Srimad Bhagavat as well as in Bhagavad Gita that yogi munis can die at will. They can go to nirvana at their will. And it is humanly impossible by a person who has not acquired those siddhi.
Actually, these are all very special powers. For instance, Bhishma was one such. Okay. And also some people who remember the past, they are called Jatismara. Okay. For instance, Jadabharata was a Jatismara. Okay. So therefore, very, very unusual, very special cases. They are big yogis and their specific yogas are there for that. They don't come under common experience.
Okay. Now it is medically possible to store organs and sperms and ova for decades together. I can take a human sperm and freeze it and keep it for 60 years, 70 years, 80 years. So it is possible for me to father my grandchild. Anybody, even after 60 years, my sperm can be used and preserved. Yeah. It is also possible that if I die suddenly and if I froze my body, if I freeze my body, I can revive my body even after days.
Before death it is frozen, that is a possibility.
Before that means the heart has stopped. But Udan Vayu, that means, can Udan Vayu and Pran Vayu be frozen in Shastra, as far as Shastra?
I'm telling you, that's correct. In fact, it's very much correct. This is.
That means your three vritti, your vaak, your manas, and your pran, they can be frozen.
It's not a question of they being frozen. It's the body being frozen. What exactly is? For instance, this is my conjecture. Oh, you see that some of the people are almost nitya. Say, for instance, Vyasa. Okay, he's living even now. For a long period, I was not believing it. But now you know, as you are yourself telling, that the body is appropriately frozen, it will continue to live. But that's the reason why I think perhaps they will be sitting in some caves full of ice and they are frozen. Whenever they feel like coming out, they will come out and once again go inside. Therefore, it is not surprising if they are alive even today. It could be possible.
It could be possible. So we'll invite a few questions from the audience. Three or four questions somebody has. Yes, please come here, introduce yourself, and come here and in the mic so that you can be in the video.
I'm Dr. Wadia. I had a few questions. If I permitted, I'll quickly ask. Like Swamiji mentioned that there are people who are lying in coma and there's no point, like 5 months, 6 months down the line. There have been quite a few cases where people have been in coma for 12 years, 13 years, and they have been revived thereafter. So as far as doctors are concerned, I don't know, they will always be in a dilemma as to when to say, okay, now this is about all and you can take them back.
I will like to answer this. The question was not where medical science says that he is revivable. There are situations in medical science where we know that this person is not going to get revived. We call them as do not resuscitate orders. In that situation we are talking about, should we shift him to the room or not? Say for example, if I tell my patients that he is not going to live for more than 12 hours. Okay, now those 12 hours, should he be in the hospital or at home? That was my question to ask. We never said that in a person of coma, send them at home. Coma means reversibility is there.
Yes.
I am only talking about a hypothetical situation where I say, now he's going to die in the next 1 hour. And that 1 hour, should it be in the hospital or should it be at home? Because Bhagavad Gita says, Uttarayan, Purnima se pehle, din ka samay, agni ke samne, roshni ke samne, moksha milta hai. That's what Bhagavad Gita says. That means, if I send that patient home, sab jagah pe light kar do, diya jala do, roshni laga do, maybe in those last half an hour, he will become more positive. His thoughts will become more positive. I am assisting natural death. That was the question.
There were a couple of terms which were used very frequently in one of the courses which I attended, and the terms were like life between lives.
Huh?
Life between lives.
Life?
Life between lives. If we believe in past lives, more than one, perhaps there is life between the two lives also. So do you, Swamiji, would you believe in that or this is just a myth?
No. See, life is, in that sense, it never dies. There's nothing like between two lives. But if you take this like this, the death now and the birth next. Between the two, if you say, it is heaven and hell there. And also, it could also be, for quite a long time, they would be in suspense. That is also possible, for a long time. For instance, at the time of Pralaya, what happens is, all the jivas will stay for a very long time and then they are born. That's also possible.
Okay, one last question.
Yeah.
Many a number of times it has been talked about that there are evil spirits and good spirits also which enter the body of an individual. And the term we use, spirit release therapy, would you believe that there's something like spirit release? Which is possible?
I don't know.
let me put down this question again. A, in our mythology, do we, my first question to his interrogatory is that in our Vedic sciences, in Hinduism, do we believe in Bhut, Prayat and Pishach?
It's there.
They are there. So that means that when you want to talk about life in between the two lives, then only you can explain with that concept. The Islam, the Sikhism, they don't talk about that. They don't, the religions who don't talk about rebirth, there this question will not come. Now, medically, if you have to talk about Bhut, Prayat and Pishach, the word Bhut is that something, somebody who is known to you, he is coming to your dreams. He's coming to, he's in touch with you. Somebody who knows you is Bhut. Prayat is somebody unknown is in touch with you, but he's not harming you. And Pishach is somebody unknown is in touch with you. That means you are getting disturbed by the presence of somebody and he is harming you. And that's Pishach. In medical science, Bhut, Prayat and Pishach comes only in the REM sleep, rapid eye movement sleep. We call them as REM sleep. That's the only time you get the knowledge of REM sleep. Medically, when somebody comes to me, ki mere ko bhoot nazar aate hain, I give them either SSRI medicine, which reduces REM sleep, or I ask him to do Hanuman Chalisa. And Hanuman Chalisa mein bhoot preet nishakanda kat nahi aave, Mahavir jab naam sunave. And in Hanuman Chalisa, a recitation of Hanuman Chalisa, if done properly, reduces your respiratory rate, because you recite the four lines in one deep breathing, it reduces your respiratory rate, it shifts you from sympathetic to parasympathetic mode, and when you reduce your respiratory rate, your REM sleep reduces. When your REM sleep reduces, the Bhut, Prayat, Pishach, which comes in REM sleep, they will reduce. Okay, I'm talking about pure science, I'm not talking about the Vedic science. Now this is the medical doctor talking about it, that. And then second thing is Bhut, Prayat, Pishach may also mean, if I don't believe in life in between life, then the explanation for Bhut, Prayat, Pishach is, say for example, my very close friend, he has given me a work. He has given me a work and he dies. So whenever I think of him, mujhe wo kaam yaad aa jata hai. And that kaam produces a guilt in me. Mere andar mein guilt aa jati hai ki maine uska kaam nahi kiya. मैंने उसका काम नहीं किया. जब तक मैं उसका काम नहीं कर दूंगा, उसकी याद मेरे को मेरे ड्रीम्स में REM स्लीप में आती रहेगी, एंड आई से उसका भूत मुझे सता रहा है. दैट फीलिंग इज देयर. एंड व्हेन आई डू माय पिंडदान, दैट मींस आई से कि मैंने उसका काम कर दिया, और आई गो टू हरिद्वार एंड डू ए पिंडदान, एंड आई से अब मेरा पिंड छोड़ दो, मैंने तेरा काम कर दिया, एंड फ्रॉम नेक्स्ट डे ही स्टॉप्स डिस्टर्बिंग यू इन योर ड्रीम्स. So there are both the answers in explanations. Medical explanation, if I don't believe in life in between life, then my answer is that it's a guilt which is causing that. But if I believe in a rebirth and a life in between the two lives, that means there is a hell and a heaven. That means Bhut Prayat is suspended license. Unko zindagi ka license nahi mila. They are in a suspension. In that theory, in a suspension, then the answer will be meditation and dhyan. Because meditation, dhyan also reduces REM sleep. In both the philosophies, his science and my science will agree, the reasons may be different, that it is possible to have Bhut, Prayat, Pishach. And when you say ki uski ruh ko nikal diya maine, that means that feeling, that guilt, you have taken it out.
What about suicidal
death? See, suicidal deaths are unnatural deaths. Suicidal deaths are always unnatural deaths. Uske saath mein jo hai. Garuda Puran talks about it, and then in a suicidal deaths are not natural deaths. They are always guilt, and there is always a treatment and prevention for that possible. Would you like to answer?
Yes, please. In non-natural deaths, this vagvritti, manovritti, pranavritti, they don't get formed properly as they should. Therefore, it certainly causes disturbance. Therefore, actually, in Shastra, special karmas are made to help him to get the vakurtis properly.
So if you talk about Shraddh in our, somebody asked me as a medical doctor, ki main Shraddh manau ki nahi manau? Somebody. I said, yes, अगर आपके कोई गिल्ट बाकी है, अगर आपके एंसेस्टर्स की किसी की कोई डिजायर बाकी है, देन यू शुड ऑब्जर्व श्राद्ध एंड देयर इज अ प्रोसीजर ऑफ श्राद्ध. श्राद्ध के अंदर में काले तिल की पूजा की जाती है एंड आयुर्वेद में इफ यू रीड अबाउट ब्लैक सेसमी सीड इट रिड्यूसेस अटैचमेंट डिसऑर्डर्स. इन श्राद्ध यू टेक कुशाग्रास, द पूजा इज ऑफ कुशाग्रास एंड यू रिमेंबर द वर्ड लव एंड कुश. लव एंड कुश ऑल्सो आर इंडिकेट्स दैट इफ यू टेक कुशाग्रास एंड रिस्पेक्ट इट यू गेट मोर लव. Loving is synonymous with Kush. Kusha is a grass which is worshipped in Maharashtra. If you take Kusha grass juice every day, it reduces REM sleep. Medically, it reduces REM sleep and Kusha grass takes care of Bhut Prayat and Pishach. So somebody says, Meko Bhut Prayat aate hain, he says, take a Kusha grass juice every day and it helps. And then here comes Ayurveda. So in every pathy, there are some answers for that. So I, as a medical doctor, can explain in both the languages. If you say, I'm a Nastic, I'll give you the medical answers. If you say, I'm an Astic, I'll give you the medical answers. So it is possible. Guma phira ke, our purpose is to heal. My person has come to me, mujhe bhoot nazar aate hain. He wants mera bhoot nikle. So, and medically, there are answers for that. There are answers for that. Any other question? Yes, please.
I am Dr. Bhatia. I must reverentially compliment Mahayogi, I'll say, who has given insights to what I have experienced in my personal lives. Whatever he has said, I endorse as a medical man, 100% right. There are transcorporeal journeys this body has undergone. There are lokas. If Gita says, Nainam Chedanti Shastrani, Nainam Dehati Pavaka, Na Chainam Kledin Tyapur, Na Shosh Ati Maruta. What he has said, yes, there is a suspended animation between what we call this physical body as the life. But yes, the journey of the soul does not know what is life, what is death. It is a continuum process, like the time. There is nothing like past, present, future when you cross these things. It's very deep philosophical, mythological thoughts, but I was absorbed in so many things that I would like to add one thing to the knowledge of everyone. I heard someone say that there is now a name for what is called the death rays. Death rays. What Swamiji has said that about vrittis, yes, whatever mansa vacha karmana, whatever is your thought, word and deed, ultimately gets impacted into form of those vrittis over the so-called the soul, the atma. And when this leaves the body, depending upon what all you have been doing, what Dr. KK so beautifully put, what Swamiji so beautifully put, depending upon papas, punyas, this becomes heavier or lighter. The more wrong deeds, mansa vacha karmana you do, thought, word and deed, you do wrong things, which are not acceptable by whatever are the tenets of the Shastras, the Vedic Vidya, your soul becomes heavier and heavier and heavier, is bound to come back again and again and again till it attains absolute purity and reaches the Brahmalok, where the last sensation, as he has said, the sensory, the last sensation of taste leaves when the soul enters into the Brahmalok. And that is the final so-called mukti, or then, you know, those are become what are called as the Jeev Muktas. Now those souls are directly under the command of the Brahma himself, and not that they cannot take a rebirth, but then that is at the command not on your karma, but on what Brahma's dictates are there. I have gone through all these experiences, making my own body to be the instrument for experiences these things, sir.
Thank you.
And last, my small submission to Swamiji is, sir, I, being a blood banker, now we have developed technologies which may be very contrary to what your thoughts may be there, or what Vedic thoughts may be there, that we are now even harvesting stem cells from the menstrual blood flow. We are even using menstrual blood to be transfused to patients to be given new life. It sounds to me a contradiction between what Shastras may say or what science believes. Thank you.
I don't think it is impossible what he mentioned, Dr. Menchan. Thing is, many times medical science or science in general, we take only the results in the at this juncture and come to conclusions about distant future. That's a big risk. In fact, for us genetically engineered crops and all that, what sort of effect it is going to have, nobody has evidence to that. Therefore, even this could lead to some complication. Therefore, in essence, what I say is, the Shastra is the quintessence of whole human wisdom. If we behave accordingly, it will give us a very peaceful life. Only at the end, I want to say one thing. In Bangalore, some doctors have been doing this. It may be very good for you, interesting for you. Once in a year, they do Dhanvantri Japa. Okay? Dhanvantri Japa, say you do every day, maybe just 108 times. That's all. Not, you may be busy, may not be able to do more than that. You take 2 months, and afterwards, all of you sit and do Dhanvantri Puja. Dhanvantri is a devata for long life and good health. It will give you a lot of insight into in the treatment of your patients. It's a suggestion I have put before you. In Bangalore, they are doing it. Since for 5 years, they are doing it, and they're all very happy. One, you can take up this.
So I'm going to have the last question. And the last question is that Swamiji said about suspended sentence. If we go to our yuga, if you talk about Satyug, Trita Yug, Dwapar Yug, and Kal Yug. In Satyug, we know they were devtas, so they were Danav also. In Trita Yug, there was Ram, so there was Ravan also. In Dwapar Yug, there was Krishna, there was Kans also. In Kal Yug, there may be a majority of Danavs, but there will be some devta. And let's become that devta and not Danav. Let's be the Satyugi in Kal Yug. Instead of saying, I'm a Kalyugi of Kal Yug, I should say, I am not a Kalyugi. It may be a 51% may be Kalyugi, but I am not a Kalyugi. And that's what I call them as my medical term, that I must teach my patients to live like a Satyugi in Kalyugi. If that's so, we also know that in Satyugi, the number of people are less. There are only 9 lakhs people. And in Kalyug, we have people in crores. And after Kalyug, the Satyug will come. And that will be the Pralaya, Mahapralaya. Whether it will be a third world war or will it be a global warming, I don't know. And when the Mahapralaya comes, and suddenly the population will become less, from crores it becomes into lakhs. And when it becomes from crores into lakhs, suppose there are 100 crore people and only 1 crore are left, and these 99 crore atmas, where will they go? They will be in suspended animation there, because they will be waiting for the rebirth. And they will have no opportunity, there will be no yonis left, no human yonis left. And that will be a classical, how I explain that suspended animation is the process. Because there will be atmas lying to wait for their turn. And they may have to wait for three yuga to get enough yonis to get. So therefore, they may be in suspended for yugas together. That's the way I look the whole thing. Maybe whether Swamiji agree or not. But that's my way of perception. I don't know whether you enjoyed it or not. I enjoyed this interaction a lot. And somebody asked me that why you're wearing a stethoscope. And that reminds me, because when you talk about dharma and religion, I say there is only one dharma. Hinduism may be a religion. Islam may be a religion. Sikhism may be a religion. There is only one dharma, and that is a dharma of humanity. And for me, is my doctor term to heal, to to help and to heal others. And I particularly feel is, if all of us adopt that as a dharma in our practice, instead of curing a patient, start healing a patient. We should start healing his manas, his vak, his actions. And if you can make my patient live a better life, that's my purpose of life. I normally say, I never ask my patient what is his age. मैं कभी नहीं पूछता तुम कितने साल के हो. If he says I'm 63, I said no. I'm not bothered about your 63. You have come to me कि मेरे 37 साल ठीक कर दो आगे वाले. So his age is 37 and not 63. So our purpose with interaction with Swamiji is let's acquire some of his qualities in our practice so that we should become a soul preacher apart from a physical preacher. Thank you very much, Swamiji.
Thank you very much.